Today, I'm going to show you a place that you'll definitely want to visit, whether you'll have a bike ride away like me or you're coming from the other side of the world. This might feel like the middle of nowhere and an unlikely place for a library, but it was a crossroads for the Romans who built a fort here. The Drummond family were granted these lands by Robert the Bruce in return for their service in the 14th century. In my video on the marriage of the thistle and the rose, I described James IV's connection to that Drummond family in his time. But it's because of an even later Drummond that I've brought you here today. Okay, I didn't come by bike. But the reason I brought you here is because this is the oldest public lending library in the land. In fact, I may say in these islands. So if you're interested in the people, places and events in Scottish history, then click the subscribe button at the bottom right hand side of the screen. In the meantime, let me tell you a story. There's a ruined castle a short way along the River Erne. It's the ruins of Innerpeffray Castle. There's been a building on that site since William Wallace was a boy. There was a chapel mentioned next door around 100 years later in 1365. It was established as a collegiate chapel at the time of James IV. Tudor times, if you're south of the border. The chapel had housed priests who were employed to pray for the souls of the Drummond family. Now, it was buffeted but survived the Reformation as a family chapel for those Drummonds who supported Charles I during the War of the Three Kingdoms. One of them fought with James Graham, Marquess of Montrose at the Battle of Tippermuir, just east of here. In fact, I've got a beautiful treat for you in that connection later, and I'll come back to that. But our story starts when that tumultuous period of civil wars across three kingdoms was over and Charles II was established on the throne. But Scotland was entering the killing times of the Covenanting years, not long before the start of the Jacobite period, where the Drummonds again supported the Stuarts. You see, David Drummond, 3rd Lord Matterday, was a bit of a reader. You might even say a scholar. And in 1680, he decided that he wanted the public to have access to read his books too. Now, I often speak disparagingly about nobility and gentry, but let's pause here to think. What the Reformation, John Knox and Presbyterianism had done was to make Scotland a literate population. What David Drummond then did was, for the first time ever, to give the general public the chance to use their literacy with access to the same library as the local lord of the manor and free of charge. And he created a fund for the upkeep. That is the revolution that took place here in 1680. Now, current COVID restrictions prevent us, but normally we could go into the chapel here, and inside at the rear, there's a set of stairs up to a little attic room above. And that little room above the chapel was Innerpeffray Library, where local folks could borrow the books that David Drummond had deposited there. 340 years ago, if you'd been able to see through this window, there would have been a tiny cramped room full of books, maybe with a local choosing one to take home from Scotland's first public lending library. Now, a little room like this with a tiny window can't have been an ideal place from which to operate. The good news is that this little room wasn't the end of things. In 1739, a later Drummond, Robert Hay Drummond, was a scholar and a clergyman who rose to become Archbishop of York, no less. But he inherited Innerpeffray. He commissioned this much larger building and added his own books to the new library that opened in 1762. So 1762 was the 80-year anniversary upgrade. Quite a thought, isn't it? It continued as a lending library right up until 1968. Now, you can't come and borrow books today, but what you can do is visit. It's a treasure trove of old, original books. Now, the reason I often bring people to visit is from a real Macbeth tour, where I tell people the story of the real Scottish king.
But if you ever wondered where Shakespeare got his nonsense from, then you can find the source that he used here at Innerpeffray in Holinshed's Chronicles of England, Scotland and Ireland, with the three witches, Banquo and all the alterations that have been made over the centuries from the real Celtic king. But there are so many other wonderful books to see here, like this 1555 copy. Let me say that again. 1555 copy of Poisson by Pierre Bellon, a hand-coloured book about fish, bound in vellum. Now, I mentioned the Drummond's connection to the Marquis of Montrose in the Battle of Tippermuir. Indeed, the founder, David Drummond, he was a brother-in-law of Montrose. And here at Innerpeffray Library, you can find the Bible that Montrose took into battle, that he'd have read to his troops at Tippermuir. Now, I'm not sure how well he understood it. It was in French. There's also a copy of Montrose's biography by George Wishart, a version of which was mockingly hung round Montrose's neck at his execution. And here is a copy of the Scots Magazine Annual of 1776, with the August edition containing a copy of those rebellious Americans' Declaration of Independence, less than 6 weeks after it was made. Earlier still, we have a map of the Americas from 1638, what you'd call New York, it lists as New Amsterdam, as it was at the time. Of course, to the west, there are huge swathes of unmapped territory. Now, there's no way that I can even scratch the surface of what you can see here, but here's a bit of fun. Why don't we play a game of Desert Island Discs? In the comment section below, let me know what's your favourite book that you would take if you were going to be stranded on a desert island. And why not check out what other folks say as well? It'll be like our wee book exchange, it'll be great. It might inspire you. But there's one more thing that I want to show you that I'm sure will inspire you. Nowadays, you'll have an electronic library card. You probably make transactions online. But here is the original remaining library card for the oldest lending library in Scotland. It's the Borrower's Register. This goes back to 1747, the year after Culloden. You can see who borrowed books, what books they borrowed. You can find out where they lived, what they did for a living. It's incredible. You can even see it in their own handwriting. Now imagine if you live in this area, some of your ancestors' handwriting might be in this book. The first female recorded in the Borrower's Register is Beatrix Fakeney, born at a nearby farm and working as a servant on the Abercairn estate, who on the 29th of August 1747 borrowed the first volume of Clarendon's Civil Wars, the History of Queen Elizabeth, and the first volume of the Complete History of Europe. Isn't that a beautiful thing? In a time where women in general weren't credited with the quality of status or intellect, here we have this rural Scottish servant girl reading European history. But this is also a document of personal development and international travel. You see, also recorded in here is Donald McComish, born in 1835, then serving his apprenticeship as a gardener at Drummond Castle nearby. Now, recently, their gardens were used to represent the gardens of Versailles in Outlander. Anyway, he borrows history books on the lives of Nelson and Wellington. But by March 1861, he's recorded as gardener at Inchbrachy. And he borrows Philip Miller's The Gardener's Dictionary, 1768. Over the years, he borrows more gardening books. And he goes on to build a successful private nursery business in this area. Some of the trees that he planted will still be growing here in Strathairn today. Now, presumably his son Malcolm joined the family business because he's also listed in the register as a nurseryman. The first time that he borrowed a book from the library was in March 1898, and the book was Oceania or England and Her Colonies by James Anthony Froude, 1886. Now, I don't know if this book was part of his research or his inspiration. But we know that he went on to emigrate to one of those colonies and settled in Queensland in Australia, where he had a sugar plantation before becoming a preacher. His own son, also Donald, retired as the chief inspector of the Commonwealth Bank of Australia, and from the other side of the world, continued to enjoy his favourite tipple of Glen Turret whiskey from just up the road here in Crieff. So this register provides a record of our old world and migration to the new one. People from all over the world tell me in the comment section below these videos how their ancestors arrived in Australia, New Zealand, Canada and America. It's funny to think that some of them may have come to this very room to make their plans. And the record of their journey started not in a port on a shipping list, but as a record in a register in the oldest library in Scotland. This is truly an interesting place and a beautiful location. Whether you're local or a world away, why not come and visit? Now, this isn't an advert. Nobody's paid me to say this, although I may have read it in a book. There's a video coming up about the man who owned the Bible that I pointed out, James Graham, the Marquess of Montrose. In the meantime, Hamiendoch is going to be a lot of my life. Cheery and Drasta.